numerous people that are out this morning. A lot of our music department, we've got some sickness and so on going on. But that's okay. God's here and we're here and that's what matters. Don't you love the Lord this morning? God is great. God is good. I want to welcome this morning Marshall, and I want to welcome Stephen in the midst of us this morning. And I pray that God somewhere or other would touch your lives through this service, and you will be able to receive what it is that you need from the Lord. Yes. I'm going to take prayer requests in just a minute, but I'm going to do something just a little bit different. If you'll bear with me this morning. I've been watching some of the news that's taken place, and a lot of it you do not see on NBC, CBS, and so on. A lot of it you have to go to the news over in Israel and different places over there. But I want to read this to you that I wrote down just to show you how close to the end that we are. If you watch the news, Israel is at war. They're at war. Now, it's pretty much official. They may not have made that great announcement, but it's official. They're in war. They're surrounded by enemy nations, and some of them are using proxy nations in order to attack Israel right now. And this has been going on for numerous days now. Iran is manipulating Syria. Russia and China are manipulating Iran, which is ancient Persia, and they together are manipulating Saudi Arabia, and it's affecting South America and Venezuela and also North Korea. Who are they targeting? They're targeting Israel and the United States. But to take the United States down, they don't even have to fire a shot. It doesn't even require a bomb. All they have to do is tamper with our fragile economy. And that's what they're already doing. Sin from within is already taking America down. Israel is now fighting on a multi-front war with multiple nations arrayed on every side of them. And biblically, what we can see very, very soon, if you will look at Isaiah chapter 17, you watch this. If you hear that the city of Damascus has been bombed, if you see that, then you might as well say, it's up. We're out of here. We're out of here. And it could happen, church, at any moment. Damascus could be bombed. Why is that important? Because of Ezekiel chapter 38 and chapter 39, the war of Gog and Magog. It could happen at any moment. All of the players, the nations that are arrayed around Israel right now are the nations of the old ancient empire that will be arrayed to fight that battle of Gog and Magog from Ezekiel 38 and 39. Will it escalate to the battle of Gog and Magog? It very well could. It's very possible. But God is going to fight for Israel one more time. And I personally believe that that will be the peace agreement that they will step up, and the Antichrist will sign that peace agreement, which tells me we will be out of here. Because the rapture could take place just before or just after that battle of Gog and Magog. Amen. I'm telling you, church, we need to be prepared to meet God. If anybody is listening to me this morning, you do not know him as your Lord and Savior, you need to get saved. Amen. We're headed out of your church. We're headed out. I know we don't know the day nor the hour, but we're children of the light, and he said we can know the seasons.
That's right.
And we are in the season of the rapture of the church, and the tribulation is just after that. And church, we need to be ready to meet God.
Amen.
So I just wanted to throw that in there this morning. Because it's vitally important that we know the Lord as our Savior.
Right.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Very quickly, if you have a prayer request, lift your hands all down. Is there one that needs to be spoken? Critical, Paula. Yes, somebody else.
My sister and my old girl just had a stroke.
My goodness. Okay. Somebody else.
My niece, they managed to put 5 stents in 2 arteries. But she's still not out of the woods. Her heart's completely blocked.
Okay.
Continue to pray.
Remember Paul Cantrell. He needs our prayers this morning. Bonnie texted me. She needs our prayers. Judy's out sick. She needs our prayers. Brandy sent me a text, and Brandy needs our prayers this morning. And, oh, mercy, I've got so many of them. Don't forget, the first week in May is May the 7th, and that's Pastor Appreciation Day. We're having a guest speaker that morning. We will probably have no Sunday school. We'll begin at 10:30, and we'll have dinner afterwards. But Carmen Humphrey, down from Harristown, South Carolina, a mighty woman of God, a great preacher, will be here that morning to preach to us. Lynn's Aunt Mary, 90 years old, she fell, she's got a broken hip. TJ, of course, lost his mother. We need to remember that family, which is Becky's aunt, which is Nancy's sister. And that funeral will be tomorrow, with the viewing from 5 to 7 at Powers. And then on Tuesday at 2 p.m. at Smyrna Methodist Church on Smyrna Road will be the funeral. Anybody else, very quickly?
I got a friend at work. His son found his roommate dead yesterday.
My goodness.
I remember him. That was his close friend. And also another friend at work, his daughter was very close to his mom and passed away back in November or October last year. And she's still grieving in extreme ways.
Okay. Remember that. Stephanie?
We asked for prayer for David and his classmates last week. They lost his classmate in that fire at Columbus at Shoal Boy. His teacher also lost her house in fire earlier this week.
My goodness.
She's a single mom with 2 boys.
Okay. Pat?
Still remember Tommy. He got on this week. He's doing a little bit better.
Just remember him. All right, stand if you're able. Stand all over the house. If not, just remain seated. We're going to pray over these. We're going to have one song. We've got to do it a little different this morning. And then we're going to receive our morning tithes and offerings after the first song. And then we'll turn it over to the music department. Is that all right with y'all this morning?
Amen.
Let's pray. Almighty God, we thank you this morning for Calvary. We thank you that we serve a prayer-answering God, a God of mercy and a God of love. Lord, there's numerous requests, so many needs, Lord. And we just praise you this morning for who you are, that you're able to meet every need in this house. There's nothing that you cannot do. There's nothing that you won't do. You're a holy God, a merciful, loving God in this house this morning. Heal, deliver, and set free. Have your way, God, in this house. Lord, touch these singers and these musicians this morning, and Almighty God, to minister to your word, that the power of Calvary would go far through this house this morning, and lives and souls would be changed, and there be a difference made in the lives of people. Lord, we love you in this house, and we glorify your holy, holy, mighty name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. We're going to have a song. If you feel led, you can stand and help them sing it. And if not, you can be seated. But let's worship with them in the house. Go ahead.
One way we're
Yes,
one day they met.
Together in my holy name this morning, Lord God, we just thank you for your provisions, your mercy and grace. God, as we receive the tithe and the offering this morning, God, we pray that you might bless it, sanctify it, and anoint it, Lord. Use it for thy kingdom, God. Bless those that have to give this morning, and bless those equally that don't have this morning. God, we give you praise and honor, Lord, for every bit of it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's worship in the house.
Thank you.
This is my name.
you love him with every breath that you breathe.
Yes.
Praise God. You know this song? Sing it with me. Sleep is gone, my heart is full of sorrow. I can't believe how much I've let you down. I dread the pain that waits for me tomorrow. When the sun reveals my broken dreams are scattered on the ground. Please forgive me. I need your grace to make it through. All I have is you. I'm at your mercy. Lord, I'll serve you.
Yes, hallelujah.
Until the dying day.
Begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. To an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you. Who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Let's pray. Father,
thank you, Jesus.
I thank you this morning for what I feel in my soul. I need you this morning, Lord. Hide me behind the cross of Calvary one more time.
Lord, as she ministers
the Take
Lord
a live call from off the fire,
Use
y'all Lord,
for your
God.
Glory, God.
Place it upon these lips of play this morning today, that I might speak
I
in
pray
your
in the mighty name of Jesus.
Father, touch, heal, deliver, and set free
your way,
in this house this
give
morning.
The glory
if there's one
morning.
Lost, if there's
yes,
a backslider that comes
Lord.
In the midst of
glory
touch
to your name,
Jesus. This morning, before it's eternally too late, we pray
glory to your
in
name,
the name
Jesus.
Of Jesus, our Lord
yes,
and
Lord.
Our Savior. And the church says,
amen.
Might be seated. Do you know that you're heirs to a resurrection body?
Yeah.
Do y'all know that? Do you know it's reserved in heaven right now waiting us?
Yeah.
Woo! At any moment, the trumpet God can sound.
Amen.
Dead in Christ is going to rise, and we which are alive and remain, we're going to be caught up together with them, and we're going to go see Jesus in heaven. Jesus says, the Bible said he was the first fruits.
Yes.
When it says he's the first fruits, that means that he's leaving a pledge that there's others coming in behind him.
Right.
And Brother Claude, that's me and you.
Yes.
That's us who know him as Lord and Savior. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15 and 14, if Christ be not risen, then is our preaching in vain, and so is our faith. And in verse 19 says, if in this life only we have hope in Christ, then we are of all men most miserable. But we got hope this morning, and we got faith this morning, that we soon going home to be with Jesus. But he said, Jesus is the first fruits of the resurrection. You know, they buried his body, but earlier on that cross, he cried out. And when he did, he said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. Y'all remember that out of the word of God? And it wasn't long until they come and begged his body, and they went and buried his body in that old tomb. And I thought about that. And I thought about the fact, if I am to die, and if I was to die even today, and I die in the Lord, they're not burying me. What they're doing is they're burying that old body. But I got news for you. Before they can get me dressed up and put me in a buggy or a box and wheel me into the church house somewhere, I want you to know I'm going to be more alive. Because I'm going to be in his presence.
That's right. Amen.
You can't even imagine what that's going to be like. Do you know what it means then that for our loved ones that had died in the Lord and they've gone in, we didn't bury them. No, sirree. And what happens is we all going to get a glorified body, a new body. Does this body up here look like it's glorified? No, not hardly. But I'm going to be in his presence. And one day, I'm going to be able to be where he's at. And I'm going to be caught up into the heavens, church. Think about it. We won't have to worry about anything anymore. We don't have to worry about cancer. We don't have to worry about diabetes. We don't have to worry about eyeglasses or hearing aids or any of that stuff whatsoever. Even insulin shots. We're going to be able to eat anything. We want to eat. Think about it, church. We're going to be eating manna from heaven up there. Glorified chicken. Hallelujah. Turkey. We're going to eat all that we want to eat.
Yes.
Not going to have any heart trouble. Not going to have any of that stuff up there. And do you believe, let me ask you the question, do you believe we're living in the last days?
Yes, I do.
Yes, certainly we are.
Yes.
When I was growing up, I used to hear the old time preachers. And they make the statement, they say we're living in a Saturday evening of time. Any of y'all ever heard that? You probably got to be older than you. But the Saturday evening of time, and what they were saying, Sean, was there's coming a new day. There's a new time coming. But I thought about verse 4. And I thought about the many miles that I have traveled in my 45 years of preaching the gospel. I mean, I've gone to camp meetings and I've gone to revivals and Lord, you name it, and I've been there. I've gone to other places and I've preached all over the country. And do you know, most of the time, if I had to go over a night, you know, and stay overnight, I did what most of all of us do. I had to make a reservation. Y'all ever had to do that? You make a reservation. And to make that reservation, Tangie, I'd call from the house. You know, I'd make me a phone call. And I'd give them my name. And I'd give them my credit card number. If I did that now, they better check it before they use it. But I'd give them my credit card number. And then I'd get to that motel. And I'd go in there and I'd give them my name again. They said, oh, yeah. We got your name. You got a reservation here. We got a place for you. But you know what? Something had to take place first for me to even do that.
Right.
What was it, Sister Luke? I had to leave my house.
Yes.
I had to leave the house. And most of the time when I did that, I'd ride in my old automobile to do it. And I want to preach this morning, or I got a reservation at my ride's a cookie.
Amen.
Hallelujah. How do you know your right to heaven, Sister Luke? Because I'm a stranger and a pilgrim in this world.
That's
this
right.
The world holds nothing for me, church.
Glory.
Hallelujah. It's not my home anymore. I'm just a passing through.
That's right.
And I got to get there somehow. And I don't care if he comes for me in a tractor or a train. It ain't gonna make me no difference just so he comes to get me. I got a ride coming, Sean. And I'm awaiting for it, and I'm going to glory. How about y'all?
Yes, yes. Yes.
You know what? You gotta have a reservation. You gotta have your name written down somewhere if you're gonna get there. But he never did ask me how he's gonna do it. I don't know if he asked old Elijah that time that Elijah went. I don't know if he did or not, but Elijah had a ride coming, and it was the chariots and the horsemen of Israel. Oh, glory be to God. I'm not saying that's what I'm going up in, but old Elijah had a ride.
That's right.
Abraham declared one time. Abraham said, I'm a pilgrim and a stranger, and you two are seeking a city which had foundations, whose builder and maker is God. That's the same city that Abraham was looking for. Yes.
Amen.
And I might be from West Virginia, but I believe I'm going to like city life when I get there.
That's right.
I'm used to the coal mines. I'm used to the country. But I like city life, especially a city that's 1,500 miles high and 1,500 Woo! Miles square. It's
yes.
A place of pearl.
Yes.
And always talk about Woo! How big the oysters have to be. You know, these pearls that big. Oh, glory be to God. You know what the best thing about it is? I don't have to pay electric bills. Because God and the land are going to be the light of that city. And you know what else? I don't have to pay any taxes over there.
Woo!
No, sir. Everything's been paid for.
Oh, yes.
Everything's been paid for, Sister Diane.
Yes.
It's signed in blood. It's the blood of Jesus.
Yes. Glory.
Morning that you are a stranger. Well, in the day we're living in, I'm strange in my salvation. You know why? Because I still believe and I still preach that there's not but one way to get to heaven.
That's right. Yes. Amen.
I'm telling you, church, there is no other way under heaven whereby man can be saved.
Amen.
There is no other name
yes.
except by the name
of Jesus.
Jesus.
Yes.
America and write your name on every church in America. You can let some
That's
shaking
right.
Shaking a preacher's hand will not get you
that's
back.
Right.
But I'm glad that Jesus saved me as a little girl when I was 9 years old and my mama was preaching a revival and I was saved under her ministry.
Amen.
Woo! And I'm still saved today. Amen. What about you?
Yes, amen.
But I'm a stranger in my salvation this morning. They're saying today that there's a lot of ways to get to heaven. Now, they can say anything they want to. I guess they got a right to be wrong because they definitely are wrong.
Amen. That's true.
But if you get there, you're going to have to go the same way everybody else goes. And that's through and by the blood. And it's true, Amanda. Some of them might get on broken pieces of the ship. He didn't guarantee us there wouldn't be some distresses along the way.
Right.
He didn't guarantee us there wouldn't be some problems and some troubles as we ride along the way. But he did say the cargo would get there. Praise God this morning.
Amen.
But I'm a stranger in my scriptures and I'm a stranger in my separation. You see, God does not want us to act like the world, look like the world, and talk like the world.
That's right.
But if you got a heart right with God, He'll set you apart. He'll sanctify you. He'll put you in a place where every day of your life you will desire to do what God wants you to do. Not because it's a set of rules somewhere, no sirree, but because you love what
yes.
He's done for you.
Yes, yes, amen.
God will know you're separated
because
you're going to have the witness of your life.
That's right.
You're not going to do like you used to do.
Right.
You hear me, church?
Yes.
Don't come to church on Sunday and go with the devil's crowd on Monday.
That's
it
right.
It does not work that way.
That's right.
Yeah, they call us strange. I'm strange in my salvation, like I said. I'm strange in my separation. I'm strange in the scriptures. And you know what? I have been tested. Y'all hear me? I've been tested, and I did not test positive to all of these new scriptures that takes out the blood and takes out the virgin birth out of the Bible.
That's right.
Oh, come on. I didn't hardly get an amen.
Amen.
And if my Bible was good enough for my mama, and my Bible was good enough for me when I was 9 years old to get saved, it's good enough to keep me right now. You know what else? I'm also a sheep. How many of you sheep in here?
Amen.
You know, they say all the time that sheep and lamb are dumb. I don't know why they say that. I guess because they follow everything that there is out there. But I think we're pretty smart if we're serving Jesus.
That's right.
I don't know about y'all. Amen. But they say that these sheep can't do much of anything on their own. They have to be led. They have to be fed. They have to be nourished. They have to be taken care of. Well, that's why we got a shepherd.
That's right.
You hear me? That's why we got a shepherd. Well, what's that got to do with having a right? Well, I'm a sheep. And David said in Psalms 23, the Lord is my shepherd,
yes.
And I shall not want.
That's
and
right.
He goes on to tell me some glorious things that's going to take place. And for time's sake, I can't say all of them, but I will tell you one that it ends with. Said, surely goodness and mercy
yes.
shall follow me all the days of my life. Church, because I got a reservation. He said, I'm going to go and prepare a place for you. And he said, if I do, I'm going to come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, you might be also. You see, our shepherd has prepared a place for us. You know, you might not believe it, but it doesn't change it. But if you're not ready to go, you're not going to go. But there is a rapture of the church.
That's right.
Well, Sister Luke, I don't believe in the rapture. That's okay. You sit right here. I'm going on.
That's
I'm
right.
I'm ready to go.
That's right.
You sit here and do what you want to do. But there is a rapture.
Yes,
you know
there
what
is.
I am? What kind of a sheep I am, Tina? I'm a found sheep.
That's right. That's right.
I was once lost, but now I'm found. I
yes.
was blind, but now I see.
Yes.
Somebody him. He came looking for me. So I'm a found sheep. He left heaven. It's called the kenosis of Jesus. He was God, but he stripped himself of deity. He took off his God qualities and he laid them aside. And he took upon himself the image of mankind. And he humbled himself. And he come down to this old world where we are at. And he died for us. He paid our
yes,
sin.
Yes, and yes,
that's what he was teaching in Sunday school this morning. And that's what Jesus did for us. But I was lost, or he was lost, church. I was lost. You were lost. And thank God he cared enough. And if I'd been the only one, he would have come down to this earth and
yes,
died for me.
Yes,
or died for
yes,
you.
Amen.
But I'm a found sheep.
Amen.
And I thank God this morning he found me. And you know what else I am? I'm a freed sheep. Because the Bible says, he who the Son sets free is free indeed. I'm not bound by the clutches of sin anymore. I don't have to sin every day. I'm glad that God got me away from that. And he'll fill me. And he'll guide me. And he'll help me in the realm of this earth down here to live the way that I ought to live. And I do believe, church, that we can live the way that this book says we can live.
Yes.
Come on, church. I believe that we can have the blessings of God on this earth as well as in heaven. But I'm a freed sheep. What about you? You know what else I am? I'm a fed sheep. Just look at me. Woo! You can tell I'm fed. Glory be to God. Sheep won't eat just anything, though. But you know a goat will? That old goat reminds me of William. William kept goats in the field in behind the house. And I used to watch him goats. And he would throw briars out there. I mean, big old long briar bushes. And them goats would just eat them bushes like they was nothing. And finally, I figured out what they was doing. You know, a briar will grow a certain way, like, let's say, up. That old goat would get that briar in his mouth, and if it was turned backwards where it's going to get a hold of his throat, he would wiggle around with his mouth, get the old briar turned around until the briars would just slide right down his throat. Mm-hmm. Isn't that amazing? That's how smart. But you know what else a goat would do? He had one of them jump the fence. Oh, mercy. I don't care how high he'd build that fence. About every week he'd come and add some wire to it. And I'd have to call and I say, William, he's done it again. Your goat's out there in the road. Come and get it. You know. But you know what? I like to stay inside the fence. Because I've got a good shepherd. I don't know about you, but I do. I'm a fed sheep. And them old goats, they would eat anything that they get their mouth on, but I'm not going to eat just anything,
that's
church.
Right. Amen.
If it don't line up with this book right here, they can get it. Hallelujah. I'm glad I got on the right ship. I did it when I was a little girl, when I first got saved, and I don't see any reason to change it now. Hallelujah. Because I got a ride coming.
Amen.
And I've got a reservation, and I don't want to go anywhere else except on the ride that he's got for me. You know what else I am? I'm a following sheep. He said, my sheep will know my voice, and a stranger they will not follow. I got a ride coming because I'm a sheep, and I'm a following sheep. You know, Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. But you know, you can't do that if you don't know the book.
That's right.
If you don't know the book, you don't know if he's following Christ or not.
That's right.
You see. But you know what else I am? I'm going to make it and follow that shepherd because I'm a suffering sheep. He said, if you suffer with me, you shall reign with me.
That's right.
And if I'm going to suffer with him, then I'm going to get to where he's at. That means I got a ride coming, church. What's that got to do with anything, Sister Luke? They tell me. Now, oh Noah, it had never rained before. He didn't know what rain was. didn't know what a boat was, didn't know what any of that was. So God said, there's a storm coming. I'll just paraphrase this thing. There's a storm coming your way. And Noah, and you and your family, you found grace in my sight. And you and your family's gonna miss the storm that's coming, but you got to build your own boat to do it. And you know he worked 120 years building that boat.
That's right.
But you know what? Stephen, it read, it got him through the boat. It got him through the storm. Yeah. He made it to the other side of the storm. You remember old Enoch? Now, Enoch walked with God. But Enoch walks, he was walking along, and I like to see him walking along one day, talking to the Lord, and they just got comfortable, and they got so far up the road. And I can hear God say, well, Enoch, we're closer to my place than we are yours. Why don't you just come and go home with me? And you know what? He went on home with it. He must have had a ride coming.
Yeah.
Oh, hallelujah, church. Give him a hand clap. When he served God. But you know what? He had a ride coming too. As a matter of fact, he got a glimpse of where he was going to when God took him into the third heaven. He showed him some things that's going to take place. Oh, glory be to God. Oh, hallelujah, church. I'm telling you, he said, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I'll go with you all the way. Even to the end of the world. Church,
yes,
it's all right to suffer for him, but you better make sure it's suffering for him and not something you did.
Amen.
Hallelujah. You know what? Y'all not going to believe this, but there's some people don't like me. Now, I know that's not none of y'all. It can't be. But you know what? I've done a lot of suffering in my life because of it. Anybody ever suffered?
Amen.
Oh, you know why they don't like? Because I preach God. And
that's
I preach
right.
The Word.
That's right.
And I do it the way God told me to do it. Hallelujah to the Lamb. They don't like it because I'm one of them daughters that Joel talked about. Yeah. He said they shall prophesy.
Woo!
Woo! Some of you are too.
Yes.
He don't like it. People don't like it because I'm one of them. Handmaidens. You know what a handmaiden is? That's a female, in case some of y'all don't know what that is. Hallelujah. But some of them don't like the fact that I do that. You know he took a woman by the name of Deborah in the Old Testament, and he made a prophetess out of her, and she was a judge on top of it.
Yes.
If you don't like it, because I preach, talk to him about it. Okay? And I'll go ahead and say it, I've said it before, if some of you men would do what you called to do, he wouldn't have to call us women. Woo! We're talking! I'm a stranger, I'm a sheep, I'm a sufferer, and I got a ride coming. And you know why? Because I'm an ambassador.
That's right.
I'm a soldier for the Lord.
Yes, amen.
That was a few years ago. The land of Egypt at that time was one of the only friends that Israel had. And it looked like they was going to get in chaos and there was going to be a war over there. So when the United States of America heard that and they thought, well, we better get our ambassadors out of there. And they ordered all of their big people, their ambassadors, come on home to the United States of America. And you know when the king of the north comes forth in the future, in the very near future, he's got to go right smack dab through Egypt in order to get to Israel, and he's going to do that. But anyway, they ordered the ambassadors of the United States to come on home, and they did. Well, now, if you was in Egypt, and they ordered you to come out of there and get home to the United States, you had to have a ride coming somewhere, or you wouldn't have got out of there.
That's right. That's right.
Am I not correct? Amen. I got a ride coming, church.
Amen.
And guess what? When this whole world begins to deteriorate, and the elements begin to fall from the sky, and the sun refuses to longer. Because the truth is, he's only coming for those that's looking for him.
That's right.
If you're not looking for him, you ain't coming anyway.
That's right.
I heard a story years ago about an old-time preacher was telling me. He was the one telling this story. And this happened, like I say, years and years ago. There was a man down on the east coast of South Carolina. And the man's name was Paul. They called him Old Paul. That's what they called him. And Old Paul never owned an automobile. He never had a driver's license. But you would find him at every camp meeting and every revival for 150 miles around. Old Paul would pee there. And nobody had thought about it. You know, he was just there. It just happened. But one day Old Paul got a word that there was a camp meeting going on at somebody's place. I can't remember the name of it. But it was 35 miles away. So Old Paul, he got to praying. And he got a message from the Holy Ghost. And the Holy Ghost said, you got to, you just start out walking because you got a ride coming. That's what he told him. So Old Paul started out walking. He hadn't gone very far, just a little bit. All of a sudden, his car went by just a flying. And it was one of the preachers that was going to preach at that camp meeting 35 miles away. And his son was driving him and just a flying down through there. And he said, wait a minute, stop the car. I know that man back there. So he did, and he turned that old automobile around. And he goes back and rolled down the windows. And he said, hey, Brother Paul, where are you going? He said, I'm going to Brother So-and-so's camp meeting. And the old preacher said, why, that's 35 miles from here. Are you going to walk all the way? And old Paul said, no, sir. He said, well, get in. He had a ride coming. He got in. And do you know they got there before the first prayer was ever prayed, before they ever sung the first song? They beat everybody to that old camp meeting. Well, that old preacher talked to the moderator at that camp meeting. We don't have no musicians come up here this morning. They all out sick, ain't they? All right, just get it ready, Terry. Just hold it back there. But anyway, he told that moderator about old Paul. And he said, find out if there's anybody in this camp meeting that's going back his way. And they actually said it was about right around 700 people was in that camp meeting that night. So they got up and they made the announcement. Stand all the house. Is anybody going to such and such a place because old Paul needs a ride? Well, out of 700 people, there was one man stood up in the whole congregation of 700 people. And when he did, old Paul stood up. He said, bless God, that's the only ride I need. Listen, church, we got a reservation and we got a ride. They're going to blow the horn. Y'all hear me, church? They're going to blow the horn. You're going to know that horn because it's an old gospel horn. And they're going to blow it until the dead in Christ is going to rise up. Oh, hallelujah. Let me ask you this morning, church. Have you got a reservation? Have you got a ride coming this morning? We're going to play a song in just a minute. And we play that song, I want you to think about it. Do you know of an assurity that Jesus Christ has saved your soul?
Yes, amen.
Have you accepted him as your Lord and your Savior?
Amen.
If you haven't, this is a good opportunity. And I'm going to let her play down on my knees. That was Brother Wayne, one of his favorite songs. And we're going to play that down on my knees. And I want you to think about it. And this altar is going to be open. And if you want to come and talk to Jesus about your soul, this altar is open. Do you hear me, church?
Amen.
And if you know anybody you need to come and pray for, you make your way to this altar and do it. Go ahead, Terry. Let's play it. I want you to listen. Come on. The altar's open. Does anybody need to pray? Anybody, anywhere? Come on, church.
Thank you.